10 mind-blowing facts about the solar system. Here we go again. Another episode about the solar system. I thought 4 episodes were enough, but you wanted more. Don't you guys ever get bored? I'm kidding. Let's get into it. Here's the first mind-blowing fact. Number 10. We may be drinking comets. Have you ever seen a comet? They're big, bright, and kind of rare today. But did you know that comets were much more common in the past? Billions of years ago, when the solar system formed, comets frequently crashed into the Earth. These icy bodies were once so widespread that some scientists believe they may have played a crucial role in forming our planet's water reservoirs. How is that possible? Well, it all comes down to the comets being made up of mostly ice, specifically water ice. When they collided with Earth, the ice melted and formed our vast bodies of water. However, there are other theories about how our oceans were formed, and some questions remain unanswered. The average comet is about 3 miles wide, so it's not surprising that a collision between a comet and Earth can have devastating effects. In fact, scientists speculate that a disastrous comet impact was responsible for the extinction of the dinosaurs. 65 million years ago, a comet measuring around 6 miles in diameter slammed into Earth. The resulting impact released energy equivalent to millions of nuclear bombs, leading to devastating consequences for the planet's inhabitants. Comets are not only fascinating, but they play an essential role in the formation of our universe. They are often referred to as dirty snowballs, a term coined by astronomer Fred Whipple in the 1950s. With their tail trailing behind them, comets are some of the most beautiful objects in our solar system. Although there are other possibilities and some questions remain, the idea that our oceans are really melted comets is probably the best. So go have yourself a glass of comet. But avoid using plastic glasses. We're already full of junk. Even the solar system is full of space debris. Most of it is found around the Earth. And it's our fault. Number 9. The solar system is full of space debris. Space debris is becoming an increasingly concerning issue in our modern world. With more and more spacecraft and satellites being launched into orbit each year, the amount of debris orbiting the Earth is rapidly increasing. This debris includes everything from spent rocket stages to broken satellites and even loose screws. While it may be easy to dismiss space debris as just another form of pollution, it poses a serious threat to both our planet and future space exploration. One of the biggest dangers of space debris is the possibility of collisions. When an object in space collides with another, it can create a chain reaction of collisions and debris that can cause serious damage to functioning spacecraft and satellites. This can lead to the loss of important scientific data and communication systems, as well as increased risk for astronauts on the International Space Station. To put this into perspective, let's look at the example of the 2009 collision between the Russian military satellite Cosmos 2251 and the American communication satellite Iridium 33. The collision generated over 2,300 fragments, which posed a serious threat to other functioning satellites in the area. While many of these fragments eventually burned up in the Earth's atmosphere, some still remain in orbit today. So what can be done to prevent this buildup of debris and reduce the risk of collisions in the future? One solution is to implement stricter regulations on spacecraft design and disposal. This includes designing spacecraft with a plan for proper disposal once their mission is complete, as well as developing technology to remove existing debris from orbit. Another solution is simply raising awareness among adults and children about the dangers of space debris. By understanding the impact that our space activities have on the environment, we can work to reduce our impact and create a cleaner, safer environment for future space exploration. Space debris is a serious issue that must be addressed in order to ensure the safety of our planet and future space exploration. While it may seem like a distant problem, it is one that affects us all and requires a collaborative effort to find solutions. By working together and raising awareness, we can create a zero-debris environment in the future. Let's get to fact number 8. Number 8. The solar system has a zodiacal diffuse light. Zodiacal light is a celestial phenomenon that paints the sky with a faint triangular glow that appears to extend from the sun's direction. This beautiful sight is produced by sunlight reflecting off cosmic dust particles, known as the interplanetary dust cloud. The cloud is composed of tiny particles that are continuously replenished by the infall from comets and collisions among the asteroids. The zodiacal light is like a shy and elusive creature, difficult to spot amidst the brightness of the moon and light pollution. It's like a whisper in a crowded room, barely audible but captivating when heard. To see it, you need to wait for the right moment, during twilight, after sunset in spring, and before sunrise in autumn, when the zodiac is at a steep angle to the horizon. The glow is really faint, easily overpowered by the brightness of the moon and light pollution, rendering it invisible. However, when seen in a clear night sky, the zodiacal light is a sight to behold. It literally paints the sky with a faint but mesmerizing glow, and it is a reminder of the vastness of our universe and the beauty that lies within it. Despite its ethereal beauty, the zodiacal light can be a noise source to astronomers. Its proximity to the ecliptic plane, where most planets and asteroids reside, can interfere with observations and make it difficult to spot faint objects in the night sky. In recent years, observations by spacecraft have uncovered significant structures in the zodiacal light, including dust bands associated with debris from particular asteroid families and several cometary trails. This discovery adds to the mystery and beauty of this celestial phenomenon, reminding us that there is always more to explore and discover in the vastness of space. For instance, did you know that the Kuiper Belt has a donut shape? Number 7. The Kuiper Belt has a donut shape. Now you may be wondering why this region filled with icy objects resembles a donut. Is it because it's Homer Simpson's favorite donut? Well, there could be a possibility, but the real reason is much more scientific. The Kuiper Belt is shaped like a donut due to the gravitational influence of Neptune. As Neptune orbits the Sun, it creates a gravitational field that attracts and repels the objects in the Kuiper Belt. These gravitational forces create gaps or holes in the ring of icy objects, giving it a donut-like shape. However, don't be fooled by its delicious appearance. The Kuiper Belt is home to some of the most interesting objects in our solar system. One of its inhabitants, Pluto, was once considered the ninth planet in our solar system, until it was reclassified as a dwarf planet in 2006. Other than Pluto, the Kuiper Belt is filled with other dwarf planets such as Haumea, Makemake, and Eris. Scientists believe that there could be hundreds of thousands of other small icy objects in the Kuiper Belt yet to be discovered. The formation of the Kuiper Belt is still a mystery to scientists. Some theories suggest that it formed in the same way as the rest of the solar system, with icy debris coming together to form larger and larger bodies. Others suggest that it could be remnants from a collision between Neptune and another planet-sized object. Regardless of how it formed, the Kuiper Belt remains a fascinating and mysterious region of our solar system. Who knows what other secrets and discoveries it holds? But for now, let's just appreciate its donut-like appearance and take comfort in the fact that even our solar system has a sweet tooth. Hey, if you're still watching the video, why don't you subscribe to the channel? And if you don't, you're gonna end up like Mercury, alone. Mercury, the planet of nothing. It's got nothing going on, no atmosphere to speak of, no rings to show off, no moons to keep it company, and definitely no life. Number 6. Mercury has no rings, no moons, no atmosphere, and no life. If Mercury was a character in Friends, it would be that weird guy who keeps popping up, but no one really knows anything about him. He's just there doing his own thing, not really contributing much to the plot. And without any life to speak of, Mercury is like the Game of Thrones series finale. It's over and done with, and we can all move on with our lives. But hey, let's not be too harsh on Mercury. Don't forget that it does have some interesting characteristics. It's the closest planet to the Sun, which means it's really hot, and its surface is full of craters and valleys, kind of like that one friend who has a face full of acne scars but still manages to look cool. So let's raise a glass to Mercury. The planet of nothing may not have much going for it, but at least it's not as annoying as Arturito in La Casa de Papel, and who knows, maybe one day we'll find some little green men living there. But until then, let's just enjoy Mercury for what it is. A planet with nothing, but a whole lot of nothing. Let's talk now about something more interesting. Have you ever noticed how meteoroids, meteors, and meteorites are three different words? That's because they are three different things. Number 5. Meteoroids, meteors, and meteorites are three different things. Now, I'm sure you're thinking, wow, astronomers really love to complicate things. And you know what? You're absolutely right. They just can't help themselves. But let's break it down a bit. Meteoroids are just space rocks. Think of them as the little siblings of asteroids. They come in all shapes and sizes, from tiny specks of dust to boulder-sized chunks. And when they enter Earth's atmosphere, they heat up and create that beautiful streak of light we call a meteor. Now here's where it gets interesting. If a meteoroid manages to survive the fiery descent through our atmosphere and makes it all the way to the ground, it officially becomes a meteorite. And let me tell you, meteorites are a big deal for astronomers. They give us a glimpse into the mysteries of the universe and can tell us a lot about the history of the solar system. So where's the best place to find meteorites? Well, anywhere there's a lot of open space for them to land. Antarctica is actually a prime spot for meteorite hunters because the icy landscape makes it easier to spot the dark rocks that have fallen from the sky. Plus, with so few people living there, there's less chance of the meteorites getting lost or damaged before they can be collected. So there you have it. Meteoroids, meteors, and meteorites. They may seem complicated, but they're really just different stages in the life of a space rock. And while astronomers may love to make things more complex than they need to be, sometimes it's just because they're so excited about the mysteries of the universe. And who can blame them for that? Anyway, talking about meteors, we have showers of them visible from the Earth. They're an awesome spectacle you don't want to miss. They are best known as shooting stars. Number 4. Meteor showers happen all over the year. But what exactly are these shooting stars? Well, meteor showers occur when Earth passes through the debris trail left by comets or asteroids. As the particles in the trail collide with our atmosphere, they create a lot of meteors in a short amount of time. This is why meteor showers are often named after the constellation that they appear to be originating from. So how can you spot a meteor shower? Firstly, you'll need to find a dark location away from city lights. Give your eyes some time to adjust to the darkness, and then look up towards the radiant, the point in the sky where the meteors appear to be coming from. You don't need any special equipment, just your eyes. The best time to spot meteor showers is usually between midnight and dawn, and that's when Earth is facing the direction of the debris trail. However, some showers can also be seen in the evening or early morning hours, depending on the specific shower and your location. If you're looking for a particular meteor shower, it's always a good idea to check online to see when it's expected to peak. Keep in mind that the number of meteors you see can vary from year to year, depending on factors like the moon's phase and weather conditions. The quadrantids are visible in December or January, the Lyrids in April, the so-called Perseids in August, the Orionids in October, the Leonids in November, and finally the Geminids in December. So mark your calendars for the next meteor shower and get ready for a magical night. Who knows, you might just make a wish on a shooting star. Now you might ask, is there an estimate of how many meteoroids collide with Earth? The answer is yes. Actually, the Earth is constantly hit by meteoroids, just like the Moon. Number 3. The Earth is constantly hit by meteoroids, just like the Moon. There are millions of tiny space rocks hurtling towards Earth and the Moon every single hour. These sporadic meteoroids are smaller than 5 centimeters and weigh less than 100 grams, but they enter the Earth's atmosphere at a rate of about 108 per hour. The impact frequency of meteoroids is crucial for understanding the potential dangers that these tiny space rocks pose to our planet and its inhabitants. While most small meteoroids burn up harmlessly in the Earth's atmosphere, larger ones can cause significant damage upon impact. And the Moon is also vulnerable to impacts from meteoroids. In fact, the lunar surface is covered in scars from countless impacts over the course of its history. By studying the impact frequency of meteoroids on the Moon, scientists can gain insights into the evolution of our solar system and the processes that shape the Moon's surface. By studying the impact frequency of meteoroids, we can unlock the secrets of our universe and better understand the potential dangers that lurk in the darkness beyond. Speaking of impacts, have you ever wondered how hard it is for a probe to go through the asteroid belt? Well, here's the answer. It's really easy. This is because the collision probe asteroid probability is very low, unlike what sci-fi movies suggest. Number 2. Collision probe asteroid probability in the asteroid belt is very low. The asteroid belt may contain millions of asteroids, but a space probe navigating through it will still miss them unless it intentionally aims towards one. Even if a probe is flying blindly at speeds comparable to those of an asteroid, it would not hit an asteroid in the main asteroid belt for 10 million years. This rarity can be compared to finding a needle in a haystack. The asteroid belt is like a vast space filled with countless hay bales, but only a few needles. The probability of a probe hitting an asteroid is so low that it is practically impossible. It's like playing a game of darts in a massive stadium with only a few targets. The chances of hitting one are minimal. The idea that a space probe will have to navigate its way through an asteroid field, dodging incoming asteroids left and right, is a myth created by Hollywood to add drama to movies. In reality, the chances of a probe hitting an asteroid in the asteroid belt are incredibly low, and it does not pose a significant threat to space missions. This is a testament to the vastness and emptiness of space, and we should appreciate how rare and unique the asteroid belt truly is. There's only one fact left. Check it out. Saturn would float. Sort of. Number 1. Saturn would float. Sort of. Yeah, you got it right. Saturn's overall density is only 70% that of water. The outer layers of the planet are actually even less dense than water. So if you could find a giant ocean with a uniform gravitational field, only the outer layers of Saturn would float like a buoyant log. But wait, there's more. As you move towards the center of Saturn, the density increases rapidly, and at about halfway towards the center, it becomes equal to that of water. And at the very center of the planet, the density can be as much as 13 times that of water. So while the outer layers of Saturn would float on water, the inner half of the planet would sink down like a heavy stone. It's kind of like a boat. The outer part of the boat, like the hull, is designed to be buoyant and float on top of the water. But the inside of the boat, like the engine and the anchor, is much denser and would sink straight to the bottom. So while Saturn may seem like a big floating ball, it's actually a bit more complicated than that. But let's be honest, it's still pretty cool to imagine Saturn floating in a giant ocean, right? Maybe we'll find one in the vastness of space someday. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. What do you think about it? Let us know in the comments below. See you next time.